Hello, everybody. Hope you are searching for a definite source to answer all your questions regarding how to make your resume or a CV and how to be successful in an interview. Now, let's go through this presentation, which deals with the guidelines to be successful in interviews. Yes, this presentation will guide you through the FAQs. Now, the agenda for this presentation would be the differences between a resume and a CV. This is one area where students always get confused. They wonder whether it's a resume that they have to submit or a CV, whether it's a CV they need to submit. So in this presentation, I will bring out a clarity of the difference between a resume and the CV. From there, I would go on to the tips for resume and CV writing. And after which, I'd be talking to you about LinkedIn, a professional profile. I'll be telling you tips on how to create your profile in a professional way so that the recruiter, when he goes through the profile, he will have a knowledge about the candidate. And then I will be talking to you about professional grooming, which is definitely a need of the hour. Your appearance does make a big difference. And then I'll be talking to you about how to gain knowledge about the company you are attending an interview. Let's move on. Let's get geared up. Let's look at the difference between a resume and a CV. See, a resume is always a summary of something called WES. WES stands for work experience, educational details, and skill. So these are the three areas which you need to highlight in a resume, and it is normally consists of one or two pages, preferably one and a half or two pages. So a resume has everything mentioned, but in specific, make sure you have your work experience, educational details, and skill mentioned. Now, looking at the CV, the curriculum vitae, it is a detailed summary of something called ISGEEK. So ISGEEK stands for individual skills, goal, education, experience, and knowledge. And your curriculum vitae should be of more than two pages. It is more of a detailed explanation about the candidate, his achievements, his goals, his qualification, his knowledge, etc. So it depends on the requirement of the company, whether you need to submit a resume or whether it's going to be a CV. Looking at the tips for writing a resume or writing a CV. The first part would deal with the career objective. And this should be very clear, well-defined, and it should be short. I would advise you not to take more than 10 to 12 words, because when the recruiter reads your career objective, it should not be too vague. So when you have a vague objective, the recruiter may not get interested in going through the entire CV. So put it as specific as possible. So remember the three words which I'm going to talk to you about when you write your career objective. First and foremost, you need to have the position mentioned. What position are you seeking for? See, for example, seeking a challenging position in an industry would be a very vague objective. So what is a challenging position according to you? So the recruiter is not going to ask you or not going to call you up and ask you about this particular objective. So as far as possible, try to mention the position you're looking for, related to the ad or the requirement of the company. The second part is you need to mention your functional area, in which function you can really carry out the job well, which is your area of interest. And the last of all is the industry wanted, or maybe the contribution, what you could contribute to the company. Let's look at an example now. Seeking for a position of junior level designer, CAD/CAM, in automobile prototyping, and to significantly contribute to the progress of the organization. So this career objective is very specific. It tells me about the position, it tells me about the functional area, and it also tells me about the contribution. So this is how a career objective should be. Looking at the educational qualification, this should always be the second step in a resume or in a CV. Because the recruiter would like to know your objective at the first rate. The second part, he would want to find out whether you are the right candidate as per qualification. So this should always be in a tabular column so that it's easy for the recruiter to identify your board of study, year of passing, your percentage, etc. So the first part would be mention the courses you have completed and put the recent course at the first. Then you have the second column dealing with the name of the institution. For example, if you say St. Joseph's Anglo-Indian Girls High Secondary School, you have to mention the place, Trichy. That's an example. Then you come on to board of study. So if it's a CBSE board or a metric board or an intermediate, whatever. And then coming on to the year of passing. And finally, it's the percentage. The next part would be the area of interest. This is a very important part for candidates who have not achieved much in the academic side. This area of interest can definitely be the candidate's area of impressing the recruiter. So try to mention area of interest according to the requirement of the job, and also see that your area of interest, you have enough knowledge about it, because you can definitely expect questions from this area. So here, the area of interest should be related only to the mainstream. So try to mention two or more than two subjects or topics. And I repeat, you need to have enough knowledge about the topics you mention, area of interest. Next, going on with the computer skills. Here, you have to specify the software you learned, the platform, the languages, the packages. So learning computer is a demand of the 21st century. And you people are Y generation learners, people born from 1981 to 2001. So these people born during this era are supposed to be tech savvy. So they need to know all technical stuff. So you cannot sit back and say, I haven't got the opportunity, I did not learn. It is mandatory. So kindly mention this pack. Coming on to next, to the in-plant training or training. Here, you just cannot write the title and leave it off. The HR should have a clear understanding when he reads about your in-plant training. So I would emphasize that you mention where you did your training, when you did it, the duration, and the objective of the training. For example, objective. Gained knowledge in machine designing. That's just an example. Coming on to the academic projects, here again you need to give a brief description of the project along with the name, duration of the project, and the objective. The objective is very important when you mention about your project, because the HR needs to get an idea about what you have learned. And so it's a kind of way where he analyzes whether you are the right candidate for his requirement. Talking about the honors and awards, you can talk about your overall achievements. You can actually put a collective form of your academic or your extracurricular or co-curricular activities, because honors and awards is one column which the HR is actually desperate to read about, to kind of know how much you have achieved and how active you have been. So I would say put all the best achievements into this column, and preferably put the best ones on the top. Moving on to the co-curricular activities, here again, put in your participation of workshops, events, programs, symposium, national conferences, international conferences, seminars, etc. Here, try to list at least 3, or the maximum could be 4. Now, in case you have about 6 and they are all very effective, definitely you can have 6 mentioned. The next part would deal with the extracurricular activities. Here, the recruiter wants to know whether you've been an all-rounder. So try to bring in information about your participation or your prize winning in music, dance, quiz, the volunteering services, the NSS, the NCC, painting, drawing, sports, dramatics, games, etc. Now, do not list more than 3. The maximum could be 4. Coming in to the personal details, the first thing you need to mention in your personal details is your date of birth. And the second part is definitely your father's name. And please start with the Mr. The next, you can write your native, then nationality. Then you can also talk about your languages known. Here, I would advise you not to have any tabular columns or any boxes put there, and only put the languages you know. For example, the first thing should be the international language, the second should be the national language, third would be the mother tongue, and the fourth would be the other learned languages. Now, so in case you have a string of 5-6 knowledge about 5-6 languages, and the last part you're not very sure, the last language you're not very sure, for example, German, you can just write that German and put it in brackets, basic. So the recruiter is able to understand that you have knowledge in all the other languages, reading, writing and listening, speaking, whereas in German alone, you have knowledge only to the basic level. Now moving on to the hobbies, just mention 2 or 3. Do not make a string of hobbies mentioned there. And coming into the address, which is very important, address for communication. Mention it with proper clarity and also mention the PIN code without forgetting. In case you're looking for a job from the government side, you need to also mention your passport number. Coming into the last part, which is the declaration, this statement should be as, I hereby declare that the above stated information is true to the best of my knowledge and belief. And beneath this, don't forget to write the place and date. And on the other side, you need to have the name typed out. So get a printout of the resume, and then you have to fill up the place, date in ink, and preferably you have to sign in front of the HR. But there again, conditions differ. There are times when the resume are collected and sent up to the HR. So in that case, you have to sign it before coming into the interview. So this is how a resume or a CV would exactly look. Don't forget to remember the differences I spoke to you about a resume. For resume, it's WES, W-E-S, and for CV, it is ISGEEK. So make sure, decide first whether you're going to submit a resume or a CV, and then arrange your CV or your resume. Let's move on to a professional website, which talks about how professionals should have their resume posted through. So it's nothing but it's LinkedIn. So first thing you have to do is follow the professional culture. You cannot have your own setup and you just go ahead. You need to know what's the professional culture and prepare your resume or your CV accordingly and have it posted. Now keep your profile picture as professional as possible. Your recruiter does not want to see you in your other kind of clothing. He would definitely be pleased or happy to see you in your professional clothing. So fix in a professional picture there. And for those of you who are well built, you can go in for a side profile picture, preferably a left or a right one. Take 2-3 shoots so you will kind of identify which profile you are, whether you are a right profile person or a left profile person. And for the ones who are just grown normal in size, I would advise you to go in for a straight shoot. Coming on to the next part, you need to keep updating your profile information. You just cannot leave it, leave it like that, because right through the years or right through the days, you keep doing different things, you keep, achieving. So make sure you update it. Coming on to the next one, mention every information very clearly. I repeat, because the HR is not going to call you up and get things clarified from you. So make things very clear. And then keep information up to date. In case you want to have an idea of how a LinkedIn profile should be, you can visit the following link, which you can see here. This profile will tell you like how a professional profile should look, and maybe all your doubts would get eradicated here. Now, professional grooming. This is the need of the hour, because the 21st century learners are more into this kind of fashion world. And the professional grooming is a big question mark these days. And this is one area which the recruitment people really look for. The first impression is the best impression. So make sure you give the right impression to your recruiter. Now, I'm going to deal with the grooming style for gentlemen. The gentlemen, you are requested to avoid dark colors. You might be a fair person or you might be tan in shade. And certain colors may throw you out well, but do not wear them on the first day of recruitment. Coming on to the next, semi-formal pants. Definitely, this is a big no For one reason, you do not get the pleat dropping right down. And when you have to go in for interviews, it's definitely a half day or a 1 day or a 2 day process. So after 2-3 sittings, you look really tired and your costume doesn't cooperate for you to have a good appearance. So that's why we emphasize not to wear semi-formal pants and avoid strong perfume. You don't want to influence somebody with some kind of scent sprayed around, do you? That's not the right way. So avoid strong perfumes. You can use soft ones or the mild ones. And now moving on to the costume, your attire. You can wear a business suit, but on condition. Make sure that the entire team or the recruitment people or the HR, whether they are wearing suits, and if they are, then you may be allowed to. But if the team is dressed in normal formal clothing, the candidate also may go in formal clothing, normal formal clothing. That would be just a shirt and a pant. And a tie, again, is optional, and again, on condition. Moving on to the buckle of belts. This is one area students fail to make the right choice of belts. You are not supposed to have buckles, scary buckles like daggers, snake heads, etc. Make sure the buckle of your belt is very professional. And your belt is supposed to be a blender. Your belt is actually supposed to be a blender between your upper body and your lower body. Your belt is actually supposed to be a blender between your upper body and your lower body. So what you can do is, first and foremost, fix your shirt and pant, and then add on your belt, which should definitely enhance the combination which you're wearing. And make sure that the color of the belt enhances the combination. Looking to the footwear, you need to have well-polished shoes. No boots, canvas, sneakers, sandals, etc. And don't forget to wear your socks. Coming on to the hairstyle, your haircut. You need to have a professional haircut. And please apply some gel if you have dry hair, or maybe a little bit of oil. And don't forget to trim your beard and mustache and your side locks. You really need to look smart. Your appearance decides a lot of things. And now over to the ladies. Professional grooming for ladies. Please avoid transparent clothing, because this is a sign of weakness. So be careful not to wear transparent clothing. And do not wear strong perfumes and deodorants. Do not use makeup, jewelry, and nail coloring. Such kind of things may not be in your favor. Talking about your clothing, you can wear a Western attire, that's a business suit, on condition. That is, if the team or the HR is also dressed in a business suit, the candidate may be allowed to wear a business suit. If not, do not wear. You can just go in with a formal shirt and pant with narrow belts. And even to the ladies, the shirt and pant should actually stand out in combination. For ladies, we always advise you to wear dark colored pants. Maybe a navy blue or a black or a dark gray or a deep brown, something like that. And the shirt, you need to have the wide collars, and the button should be really stretched very close so that nothing is revealed. And don't forget to choose belts which are really narrow. This is the trend of today. So try to present yourself as trendy as possible, but as a professional. And moving on, if you're deciding to go in for an Indian wear, you can wear salwars, and preferably cotton. For one reason, cotton makes you feel comfortable, and it gives you a crisp look. You don't get crushed up by the end of the day. And your dupattas, you can wear it one side or both the sides. It's up to you. And no short tops, no leggings, and no patiala. These things do not give you a professional look. And moving on to your footwear, please wear low heels. You don't have to wear, you know, big heels and make yourself look really tall and making it really obvious that you are kind of seeking attention or trying to look too tall. So wear low heels, and please do not wear noisy footwear. Please check your footwear before you come in for your interview. And if you're deciding to wear a Western attire, your shoes must be well polished and toes must be covered. If you're wearing an Indian suit, your toes can be revealed, and maybe you can have some nail coloring for your toes. Going on to your hairstyle, style it to suit your attire. You're not supposed to have loose hair. Your hair should not be falling on your face, and your hair can irritate the HR as well as it can irritate you. So put by your hair, see that it doesn't fall on your face. And if you're wearing a Western attire, you can have a bun or you can have a high ponytail, depending on the features of your face. If you have sharp features, I would advise you to go in for a high ponytail. And if you have round features, go in for a bun. Going into the Indian style, you can have a ponytail, either a full one or a half. And or if you're not comfortable, you can just plait it up. So ladies, try to look as professional as possible and avoid things from the fashion industry on a day of interview. Let's move on to how to research a company for a job interview. Now, this is definitely optional. You're not, it's not mandatory for you to have knowledge about the company. But however, I would suggest that if you have knowledge about the company, it gives you an understanding whether you are the right person for the job and whether you're growing in the right way. So let's look at how to get knowledge about the company. First and foremost, you can visit the company website. Run through all the events which is posted in the website. Apart from this, you can look into social profiles of the company, including LinkedIn and social websites. You can also find out about the recent projects and the future prospects of the company. So you will know whether you are going to work in your area of interest. This will give you a clarity there. Then you can also keep in mind to look for questions like who is the CEO, its headquarters, number of employees, annual turnover, annual profit, sectors of operations, etc. And do not run up to your HR and tell him, I've read through the company and I'm so knowledgeable about it. And, you know, try to brag about it. Just have it in your mind. And when time permits or if it's the need of the hour, you may project that you have read through the website and you are having some knowledge about it. Or you can always say, I read this and I just love it. It was amazing. This is one way to show your interest in a positive way. You might find something which is not your cup of tea, but do not mention it to your HR. You just have to keep that away when you are at the interview. Now, you can also know about the clients of the company and the competitors of the company. This again would tell you whether you are heading to the right track. And you can also gain knowledge about the working environment. You can also access the press area of the website. This will give you an extra information about the company in public perspective. And last of all, if you have the opportunity, read through the company's annual quotation and documents. So this is all you can do. And in case you're looking for a company which does not have a website, in such conditions, I would advise you to go in person to the company, you know, get to see things, get talking to people, and try to get a lot of knowledge. At the end of the day, we don't want you to be sad and say, I did not know these things about the company. Had I wouldn't have come here. So we don't want any regrets. So let's put in our kind of research before we get into a job interview. And thank you for your valuable time.